Hello everyone, I'm Rama and I teach computer science at Malia Aditi International School, Bangalore for grades 9 to 12. At the start of each course, I love to introduce puzzles to the students who have chosen computer science as their elective. Now, some of them are unsure whether they should be taking this up as a subject. There are some others who are just there because they feel they are computer savvy, which means they're good at searching, surfing, and so on, but may not be good at problem solving. So this has been my practice for several years now. Now, some of the advantages that I find in introducing puzzles or starting a lesson with puzzles is that it becomes a very interesting ice-breaking activity. Students tend to forget that they're in a new environment and they don't have to worry about any programming language and so on. They're happy to work in groups. This is something that grabs your attention and kindles their interest in the subject because there are many who come in unsure of whether they need to take this forward. It is also something that I use to build problem-solving skills without realizing that it is happening. So you look at a complex problem, and if you need to solve it, you may worry about whether you're going to get to the solution at all. But if you break it down, if you decompose that complex problem and make it into smaller problems that can be addressed individually, it becomes easier. So that is a kind of experience I like to give my students. And believe me, after the first lesson, people who are sitting on the fence wondering if computer science and programming is their forte, I have seen many have been converted to computer science for life. So I have an example here which I kind of introduce to classes from 10th grade or 11th grade, and this is the leapfrog puzzle. So let's see how it goes. Thank you. The problem has been shown to you and the outcome. Now, what are the rules? The boxes from the left can move only to the right, and similarly, the boxes from the right can only move left, which also means that they cannot move back, take steps back. The boxes can move one space forward, or they can move two spaces forward by jumping over or moving past another box of the opposite side or one of the different color. The moves are to be made in one direction, as mentioned earlier. The puzzle is completed when the two sets of boxes have switched positions.
Hello everyone, my name is Manomit Paikroy and I am a computer science teacher for the past 3 years. I have taught in various government schools across Maharashtra and I always try to relate computational thinking to our daily life activities. Today, I will share my experience of teaching at a community center in Yerwada, where along with the students, I also taught a computational thinking to their parents and I will try to link it to their daily life activities. In this presentation, I will focus mostly on the impact on students' learning after involving the parents. Just to briefly tell you about Yerwada, it is one of the most densely populated area of Pune. The students in the community come from different culture and economic background. The main objective of the program was to give an opportunity to students to explore computer science and make them understand how computational thinking is incorporated to their daily life activity. There I taught two batches of 20 students and also taught approx 40 mothers. There were weekly two sessions for students and fortnightly one session with mothers. There are some pictures of the city session, one of the city session, our SAP code kare, where the mothers were involved. And here they are understanding city with the example of making bread, which is also called as a roti. And that's why the picture reads our recipe code kare. We conduct a city for the 40 mothers led by their kids. And after the completion of the session, we awarded certificate to parents to encourage their effort. If we talk about the challenges, one of them was that after a few sessions with the students, we observed that the students' engagement was decreasing. The number of students turning up for the session went down by approx 40%. And then that also led a gender disparity in the batch. The main reason was gender disparity was the involvement of girls in household work. As most of the time, they were helping mothers with the housework. To solve this problem, we plan to involve our parents in our city program and give an opportunity to parents, especially mothers, to explore computer science. So that they have a clear idea of what computational thinking is all about and how they can support their children to actively participate in this program. Initially, parents did not agree, but after having one or two conversations with them, they turned up for the sessions. However, there was one more challenge. Most of the time, mothers were busy with household work and would not be able to come for the sessions. To solve this problem, we planned a session in a way that is more convenient to the mother's work schedule and also plan to award the certificates to motivate and encourage that age is no bar to learn computer science. If we look at the impact graph, the impact is categorized into three buckets. First one is students' engagement. Second one is problem solving abilities. And third one is logical and creative thinking. After students' mother were being integrated into the program, we noticed a shift in students' learning interest that resulted in growth in logical and creative thinking. It was also observed that the students' engagement increased from 55% to 75% after involvement of mothers in the session. As a result of which, a significant increase of 60% in students' problem solving ability was observed. We also did an annual project. And for the showcase, I gave my students a task to identify a problem they face in their everyday life. Most of the students come with a problem of water scarcity in their locality. So we decided to solve this problem and formed two groups. One group was led by Sakshi and other group was led by Raman. Both the groups come up with the different solutions to solve this problem with CS concept. Another student named Shehzan Sheikh, who is tech savvy, used to spend extra hours after the session and tinker. Similarly, there were other students who created projects by leveraging CS concepts for different problems they were facing. These are some of the impact stories of students and parents. And for now, this is all from my side. I would love to answer any questions if you have. Thank you very much for listening.
Good morning, everyone. I am Kavleen Kaur from Credo Learnings. Today, I'm going to talk about computational thinking education for students in the grade kindergarten to grade 5. It is very difficult to predict the future. We don't know for sure what sort of jobs our children will have when they grow up. Hence, it is very necessary that we as educators and parents prepare our children for this unpredictable future by supplementing the traditional curriculum with 21st century skill. One of these skills are, of course, computational thinking. We at Credo Learning teach computational thinking skills to young children from the age 4 to age 11. Now, this may seem as a very young age to pick up these skills, but research has shown that, and our own experience also supports that, that children in this age category are natural computational thinkers. They use these concepts to make sense of the world around them. So what is necessary is to systematically teach them these skills using the right curriculum and the right learning aids. At Credo Learning, we have a specially designed curriculum for such young kids, and our methodology uses multiple learning aids to teach these concepts to them, to introduce the concepts and then help them repeatedly practice these concepts using the various learning aids. Now, coming to the activity that we do that I'm going to talk about today is related to the fact that computational thinking skills should not be taught as a standalone subject, but should be blended with multiple other subjects. And for such young kids, we can also use real life activities to introduce these concepts to the young children. Now, these young children love to role play. They love taking up various personas like firefighter, bank officer, astronaut, a chef, and other such roles. And they also love the various characters. So we have blended all these and created activities wherein we have these characters take up different roles and do the everyday services that they see around them. And all this happens in a fantasy world known as Credo Cosmos. So today, this character Cody will talk about the everyday service of courier delivery. Nowadays, since pandemic, the children are seeing their parents doing online shopping and lot of couriers being delivered to home. So they are very inquisitive about this service as a whole. So this courier delivery activity that we are talking about today happens in a fictitious town known as Credo Town. It is a set of houses, offices, and of course the courier headquarters. And it is made up of grid for the easy learning of the activity. The children have to guide Cody to go to the right address and deliver the package. They would have at their disposal a set of commands which we will see as we move forward. But before we do the activity, we talk about what all a good courier service should ensure. And of course, the children come up with answers like, my birthday present should reach me before my birthday and not afterwards. And my present should reach my house and not somebody else in the neighborhood. So this opens up an opportunity for a very healthy discussion about the courier service itself. So once that is done, then we introduce the toolbox, which has four commands, which the children can use to guide Cody to move forward, turn left or right. And when he reaches the right address, then he is guided to give the package by using the deliver command. Now, this is activity number one, wherein Cody has to deliver the package to house marked H1. It is a pretty straightforward solution, and the children are able to create the right sequence of steps to guide Cody to this house. And this right sequence consists of four move forwards for Cody to reach this destination, and once he has reached, then he uses the deliver command to give the address. So this was activity number one. Moving on to activity number two, here again Cody has to deliver a package to just one house, and that is marked as H2, but this is further away from the courier delivery headquarters, so Cody has to move a longer distance. And also, what is different in this activity is that there are multiple routes to reach this destination. So there is route 1 consisting of 10 steps, and then there is route 2 consisting of 16 steps. So there is this yellow route and the red route. So this opens an opportunity for discussion about multiple routes, why we should enumerate multiple routes. And the second is that if we have multiple routes, which route Cody should take? So which is the most efficient route, which is the which is the shortest route? So this opens the opportunity to discuss about all these essential routing related concepts, and why we should have multiple routes. That it may be because of traffic jams, it may be there could be a breakdown in road, so that necessitates finding out not just one but multiple routes to a destination, and then we help children identify the shortest route also. So they create a sequence of steps, and once they have done that, we introduce the concept of algorithm as a sequence of steps to finish a task, as a sequence of steps for Cody to reach the right destination and deliver the package. So the way we do is that we do the activity first, and then we introduce the concept or the definition of the concept. Since we are dealing with very young children, they may not necessarily remember the definition, but they definitely pick up, you know, how to apply that concept, how that concept is used in various everyday scenarios. So once they have done these two simple activities, then you know we have multiple such activities of courier delivery in this town, wherein we have multiple houses, two destinations, three destinations, and they may be the destinations are spread all over the map, so the children have to take longer routes to reach the destination. So we have a set of about 12 such activities that the children do, ranging from a very simple to slightly more complex, and activities where there are possibilities of more than one routes. Once the children have done that, we give them a blank map also, and they can design their own maps and choose their own destination, and then ask their partner to create the algorithms for this. So there is scope for multiple new activities to be designed related to this map. At the end of this activity, the key learnings are, of course, multiple routes and efficient routes. Then the concept of sequencing, the concept of algorithms, creating their own maps. And last but not the least, the key outcome of this activity is that the children appreciate that algorithm, although it is a computer science concept, it is not limited to computer science, but algorithms are everywhere around them. We also talk about the right sequence of steps or algorithm to get ready for school in the morning, for example, or to create lemonade, or other such everyday activities that the children do. So this is about developing algorithmic thinking, not just for their academic subjects, but for the everyday activity also. So this was one example of the activity that we do. We have various such activities which enforce the computational thinking concepts using everyday examples for these children. And there is tremendous scope for teaching such young children these concepts, and they then go back and also apply these concepts in their school and also at home. I would like to thank CS Pathshala for inviting me to talk about this activity, and I would be pleased to share more such activities that we do related to real life for young children in this age category. Thank you very much.